Hello folks, welcome to the next episode of Electromagnetism. Today we're going to be solving more problems involving solving the Laplacian in rectangular coordinates. Let's start with a brief lecture that reviews how we generally solve such problems.
You said it's a slow ride, everything is gonna be alright. All I gotta do is just hold tight, everything is gonna be fine.
Recall that the Laplace shift is applicable in scenarios where the volume charge density is zero. In other words, the Laplacian is simply Poisson's equation, but with zero volume charge density. And this is Laplace, this is Poisson. Now recall that we solved Poisson's equation for the electric potential, and thus we got the electric potential for volume charge density to be as follows. V is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught times the integral of the volume charge density times dr prime cubed over r. So this was generally the formula for electrostatic potential that we derived by solving Poisson's equation for V. Now what we're trying to do is solve Laplace's equation for B. But Laplace's equation has zero on the right hand side instead of negative rho over epsilon naught. So how did we solve it? Here's how we solve it. We start by assuming that V, the electric potential, is a separable function, that V may be separated as a function of x and a function of y. After assuming that, what we do is plug that in over here, and what we get is the following. We get the following differential equation, partial differential equation, where we have x double prime over x plus y double prime over y is equal to zero. Now this is the case for when we have two coordinates, x and y, but this can be easily extended to three coordinates. If you have z of z, then you'd simply add one more term, z double prime over z, as we'll see in today's problem. But anyway, this was the general idea for the differential equation that you would get. And if you'd like a full derivation of how we got to this step, simply rewatch the previous lecture. Now, after we got to this stage, we had to make a decision. Our decision to make was what kind of function would x and y be? Would they be exponentials or sinusoidals? Would they be an oscillating function or a non-oscillating function? And to make that decision, we had to take a look at our boundary conditions. The boundary conditions are very important because they're the physical part of the problem. This is the mathematics. To choose the right function for x and y, we have to look at the physical conditions. Those are implied by the boundary conditions. So, for example, if the boundary conditions say that x has to repeat, the electric potential in the x direction has to start at zero and end at zero, or start at some non-zero value and assume that non-zero value some point in the future, then that's a hint. You need to be using a sinusoidal. If, on the other hand, you see that the potential is starting at some value and then just dropping off slowly, then that's a hint you need to use exponentials, okay? So, take a look at your boundary conditions. That will help you decide what kind of function x and y should be. So let's say x is an exponential and y is a sinusoidal. What do you do after that? After deciding what kind of functions you should choose for x and y, you form the general function for the electric potential. So you would write x of x is some linear combination of exponentials. So it would be some combination of a growing exponential and a decaying exponential, e to the minus kx. And y of y would be a linear combination of sinusoidals. For example, cosine. No, we always start with sine, although you can start with cosine, but really it's convention to start with sine, plus d cosine cox, right? So you have a combination of sine and cosines, a combination of growing exponentials and decaying exponentials. This really gives you a lot of customizability, right? You can now create any sort of electric potential that you want in the x or the y directions, because now you have a basis set of functions that spans the entire space of R2. So now that you've decided what your x and y function should be, now we can write the general electric potential function as a summation. So we can write V for the electric potential, hopefully you can still see over here, is equal to the sum over m equals 1 to infinity. Now, if there was another dimension, for example, z of z, and another term, therefore, over here, I would have two summations. But now, since I just have one constant k, as you can see over here, I have only one summation. Okay, so we have the summation from m equals 1 to infinity of c sub m x of x times y of y. And in this case, x of x is this exponential, y of y is this sinusoidal. Of course, your boundary conditions would also help you remove some of these terms over here and help you figure out what k is. For example, in most cases, k would be something like n pi a over x, okay? Now, after you do that, you have only one more step to go. After you figure out your electric potential as a function of x and y, only one more step is left, and that is to determine the expansion coefficient, c sub n. How do you determine the expansion coefficient? Remember, we use Fourier's trick. Fourier's trick is based on one and only one integral, and that is as follows. The integral is that the sine of n pi, let's say x over a, times sine of n prime pi x over a dx as we go from 0 to a is equal to a over 2 if n equals n prime and 0 if n does not equal n prime. And so what you're left with at the end of the day is only those terms where n equals n prime. And so that's how you determine the expansion coefficient, c sub n. So let's go ahead to take a look at our first problem that's going to help us take a look at what we do when there's one more dimension involved, z of z, and furthermore, when only part of a surface has a non-zero potential. Let's take a look. Here is another view of problem one. Let's take a look at problem one. Alright, so here's our problem. A conducting wall rectangular box with x between 0 and a, y between 0 and b, and z between 0 and d has every side grounded except the top at z equals d, which is arranged such that half of the face is grounded when you are between y is 0 and b over 2, but the other half is held at a constant potential v naught when y is between b over 2 and b. Find the potential, the electrostatic potential, inside the box. Okay, what's our game plan? We first begin with Laplace's equation, right, which states that lambda squared v is equal to 0. Does that apply here? Can we use the Laplacian equation? Well, there are no charges inside the box. The problem does not explicitly state this, but if there were any charges, that would be explicitly stated. So we can safely use the Laplacian equation. Now, the Laplacian equation assumes that v is a function of x and y, and so that it is separable. And so we end up with a second order partial differential equation, which leads us to the following conclusion, that x is either an exponential or a sinusoidal, and likewise for y. And now, based on the boundary conditions, we must make a decision on what type of function x and y must be. So, let's write out our boundary conditions. Here are our boundary conditions. Let's take a look first in the x direction. We know that every face is grounded. So let's start off with x equals 0, which would be right in the back. So what would the back face be? V of x is 0, and y and z can be anything there, but the electric potential will be 0, right? Because that back face is grounded. What about the front face? Well, you come all the way over here, you're walking in the x direction, you've come to x equals a, and you still see that the electric potential is 0. So maybe it was non-zero in between, of course it certainly should have been non-zero in between, but at those ends, at those boundaries, the electric potential is certainly 0, because both of those faces, the front and the back, the front and the back are grounded. Let me just label these faces for those who may be confused what I'm referring to. This is the back face, this is the front face. Back when x is 0, front when x is a. Back, front. What about our left and right sides? Well, our left side is when y is 0, right? X can be anything, z can be anything, but y is 0. So when y is 0, the electric potential is also 0, right? Because that left face is also grounded, right? Every face is grounded, remember, except the top. What about our right face? How do we express that? Well, we start over here when y is 0, that's our left face, and then walk, 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 walk. This right here when y is b, when you've traveled b units, is when the electric potential is again 0. And that is the right-hand face. Okay, so we know this rectangular prism has 6 faces, 5 of which are grounded and one of which is partially grounded. So we've got 4 of our boundary conditions here. Where's the other 2 faces? Well, one face is this bottom face right here when z equals 0. X and y can certainly be anything, but z is 0. This is the bottom face, and it has 0 electric potential. It's grounded. But the final face has a caveat. It comes with a caveat, and that is that only half of it is grounded. Only half of it has an electric potential of 0. So when x and y are anything but z is equal to d, the electric potential is either v naught, actually let's start with the lower condition, is either 0 if y is between 0 and b over 2, or v naught if y is between b over 2 and b. And that is the top face. So as you can see, we've got 5 faces that are grounded, one of which is partially, and the last face which is partially grounded. Now let's go ahead and apply these boundary conditions and use these to figure out what type of functions x and y should be. Okay, so first let's take a look at x. If we're looking at the x direction, what should we consider? Which set of functions should we consider? Let me make some space here. This is y. So if we're looking at the x direction, we should consider these pair of functions. Because this is when x is 0, the back face, this is when x is a, the front face. If we're considering y boundary conditions, we should consider this pair, when y is 0 and when y is b, the left and right faces. And if we're considering z boundary conditions, we should consider this pair of boundary conditions, when z is 0, the bottom face, and when z is d, the top face, which is the partially grounded face. So if we're considering the x potential function, let's take a look at this first pair of electric potentials. You see that the electric potential for x starts at 0 and it ends at 0, right? So the boundary conditions start and end with the same value, 0. That means x must be an oscillating function. It must be a sinusoidal. Okay, what about the y? Actually, in this case, there's also a z direction, which I neglected to add. So this is a z, and we also have to decide if that's an exponential or sinusoidal based on looking at this. And there should be a z of z multiplied over here as well. So y of y, let's take a look at y of y. Again, you see that y starts with an electric potential of 0 at the left face, and it ends with an electric potential of 0 at the right face. 0 here, 0 here. I don't care what's in between, I just care about the boundaries. Since the electric potential in the y direction repeats itself, I know that y must be an oscillating function. It must be a sinusoidal. And what about z of z? For z, you see that z starts at 0, but depending on where you are, it's either coming back to 0 or it's v naught. And actually, in this case, z is going to be an exponential function, because we want to choose the function that has the most customizability, the function that we can force to be 0 if we want, or we can make v naught if we want. And that function is going to be an exponential. So now that we've decided what kind of functions x, y, and z should be, let's write them out using general constants such as a, b, c, d. So I'm going to write out the general expressions in the x, y, and z directions right here. Y, likewise, and sinusoidal. Hence, I will write C sine. Now I'm going to use a different variable because now we have 3 dimensions. So let's use L, for example. Ly plus D cosine Ly. And finally, for the Z direction, Z of Z, Okay, so I've got my three general functions for x, y, and z here. Now you might be puzzled, why is there a square root of k squared plus l squared in the exponentials? Let me show you why. This is just coming straight out of differential equations. The reason why you have that is because take a look. What happens when I differentiate this twice? If I differentiate this twice, I'm going to get a pair. I'm going to get square root of k squared plus l squared out of the first time, another k squared plus l squared the second time for my second derivative. So z double prime will look something like this, k squared plus l squared times my exponential. And remember, when I take the derivative for my sinusoidals, I'm also going to get k squared minus k squared and minus l squared. Minus k squared coming out of x double prime and minus l squared coming out of y double prime. When I add all of those up, it should give me zero. That's why z double prime is equal to the square root of the exponential to the square root of k squared plus l squared. So that at the end, when you add all the terms up, it gives you a big fat zero. Okay, so now that we've decided what type of functions x, y, and z should be, we're going to use our boundary conditions to enforce restrictions on what these constants a, b, c, d, e, and f should be. So let's get started. Let's start with the first one. When x is zero at the back face, the electric potential is zero. What does this tell me? This tells me that I cannot have a cosine term, as we've seen in our previous two problems. Go ahead and watch those back, because I'm going to skip one step here, which is plugging in that x is zero and showing that b actually has to be zero. But intuitively, you know that if x is zero and the potential is zero, well, cosine is not zero when x is zero. Hence, this term must die. We must get rid of this term. If you want to see the full steps, go ahead, look at the past two lectures and you'll see me work out. When I plug in x is zero, you'll see that b must be zero for the solution to work. So we have enforced the first boundary condition. Let me label these boundary conditions. Okay. So b must be zero by boundary condition one. So boundary condition one tells us our electric potential must be zero at the left face, and thus we cannot have a cosine term. Likewise for the y term, right? Y is also composed of two sinusoidals, but again, when we're at, sorry, this was the back face. For y, when we're at the left face, the potential is zero, right? So we cannot start with a non-zero potential. The potential when you're at the left face is zero, hence again, you cannot have a cosine term. So this d, constant d, is zero by boundary condition three. Okay, is there anything else we can do? Let's apply this boundary condition. Since zero seemed to work out fine, let's apply this one. So this boundary condition tells me when z is zero on the bottom face, my electric potential had better be zero. So let's plug that in. When z is zero, my exponentials will die out. E to the whatever times zero is just one. E to the whatever times zero is just one. So I'm left with E minus F is, sorry, this should be a plus sign. I'm left with E plus F is zero. Is zero. Hence, E must be minus F. In other words, the two constants are negatives of one another, right? So the two constants are negatives of one another. So what does that mean? We've just figured out that F is no more than minus E by boundary condition five. By boundary condition five. So we have applied three of our six boundary conditions. Let's apply those other two over there. Let's apply boundary condition two, which says that when you're at the front face, when X is A, the potential had better be zero. If you looked at our past two lectures, you would see when I plug in x equals a here, of course I don't have a cosine term anymore. I simply have a sine ka is zero. Well, when is sine of ka zero? When ka is a multiple of pi, right? Hence, our second boundary condition tells us that k must be n pi over a. K is n pi over a by the second boundary condition. And likewise for L, the constant L is equal to what? Well, when Y is B, the electric potential must be zero. And thus the constant L must be equal to N, not M. We have to use different constants since there's a third dimension. So let's use M for this one and N for this one. So N pi over B. And this constant L must be N pi over B because of the fourth boundary condition. Okay, and of course the sixth boundary condition, the last boundary condition, we're going to leave alone until we use Fourier's trick. So now let's go ahead and write down what our general electric potential function for this problem should be. So what do we have? We have the electric potential V as a function of X, Y, and Z is equal to, now we're going to have not one, but two summations. One summing over this integer constant M and one summing over this integer constant N. And they both go from 1 to infinity. Okay, so we know x of x. First, let me write down the expansion coefficient, C sub mn. Now, we know x of x just consists of a sine term. The cosine term died out due to the first boundary condition. So we simply will have sine of m pi x over a. M pi x over a. Okay. What about y of y? Y of y is sine of n pi y over b. Sine of n pi y over b. And finally, z of z is the difference of a growing and a decaying exponential. So we're going to have e to the square root of, now we know what k and l are. K is m pi over a, l is n pi over a. So we're going to have e to the m pi over a squared plus n pi over b squared all times z minus the same thing but now with a decaying exponential. E to the minus square root of m pi over a squared plus n pi over b squared all multiplied by z. So there you have it. That entire thing is our electric potential function. This is only half the answer though, because now we have to find the expansion coefficient C sub mn. So what we're going to do is employ Fourier's trick. We're going to take all of this and multiply it by the following integral. One integral for the m going from 0 to a, multiplying by integrating sine of m prime pi x over a dx, and one integral for the n variable, integrating from 0 to b, sine of n prime pi y over b dy. These two brackets simply mean we're multiplying both sides by this product of two integrals. So when we multiply this by the left side, well, the left side, when you plug in z as d, what is the left side? Everything stays the same, except z may now be simply replaced with d when you impose the final boundary condition. Boundary condition 6, z simply turns into d and all else remains the same. And now, when we multiply both sides by this, on the left-hand side, I will simply have a constant. Because remember, on the part of the top face that is not grounded, we simply have a constant potential V naught. And so we have V naught multiplied by these two integrals. So here's what we're going to have. We have V naught times the integral of sine of m prime pi x over a dx from 0 to a, and likewise for sine of n prime. Except that's from 0 to b. Or is it? No, because only half of the face is grounded. The part of the face from b over 2 to b, not from 0 to b, from b over 2 to b. So that's the difference, that half of that, making half of the face equal to a non-zero potential makes. Okay, if it was the whole face that was non-zero, then the lower limit would be 0. But only half of the face is a non-zero potential. So you must have a lower limit, which is b over 2. So now we're going to have sine of n prime pi y over b dy. So that's going to be your left hand side. So this is going to equal what's left on the right hand side. Well, what's left? Well, since I'm integrating by using Fourier straight, only those terms where m is equal to m prime and n is equal to n prime will survive. And so hence, at the end, I will be simply left with c sub m prime n prime, a over 2, b over 2, and my entire exponential, which actually you can write using the hyperbolic sine function, but I do not want to confuse my audience. I will simply peruse what I have here, a difference of two exponentials, n pi over b squared d minus the decaying exponential, m pi over a squared plus n pi over b squared, all multiplied by d. Okay, well now all I have to do is solve for c sub m prime n prime, and that's pretty easy. So c sub m prime n prime is equal to what? Well, can I do these two integrals? The answer, yes I can. These are two very simple integrals. They're simply, all you have to do is take their antiderivative, so let's do that. So this integral is going to work out to be minus cosine, actually minus a over m prime pi cosine of m prime pi x over a. As x goes from 0 to a, don't forget we're multiplying all of this by the constant potential v naught. And likewise for this one, right? You're going to have something like b over n prime y, b over n prime pi times cosine of all of this. So why don't I write that out? We're going to have times minus b over n prime pi cosine of n prime pi y over b as y goes from b over 2 to b. So that is what you have on the left hand side. Okay, so let's go ahead and simplify this. Let me simplify this from cosine. So first of all, minus and minus, that's going to give us a positive. So we'll have v naught times ab over m prime n prime pi squared, and now I can do these cosine business. So first, when I plug in a, I'm simply going to have cosine of m prime pi, and then when I plug in 0, I'll simply have 1, right? Cosine of 0 being 1. Multiply this by the second cosine term, which is going to be plugging in b, which is n prime pi, minus cosine of, well here if I plug in b over 2, I'll simply be left with n prime pi over 2. So this is going to give me n prime pi over 2. And now all I have to do is write out my final answer for c sub m prime n prime. So c sub n prime, if I bring this ab over 4 to the other side, my ab's will cancel out and I will have 4 over m prime pi squared, a factor of v naught on the top, and these two cosine terms on the top, cosine of m prime pi minus 1 times cosine of n prime pi minus cosine of n. So our final answer is all of this divided by difference in exponentials, which is, I'm writing the exact same thing, my difference in exponentials, just using a little bit of a different notation, just using something called hyperbolic sine. If you can search it up. If you're wondering, hyperbolic sine has a factor of a half, which I did not show here because that's absorbed into the expansion coefficient. So you don't have to worry about that. So we're left with sin h of m prime over a squared plus n prime pi over b squared. Okay, all times d. And folks, that is the final answer for our problem. We'll see you in the next lecture.